If you've been following my channel long enough, you would know that I'm not exactly the patient type. I mean, you're talking to the guy with a self-proclaimed unofficial world record for fastest grain to glass time. Even brewers like myself need to slow down and wait for a beer to reach its peak potential, and that's exactly what I did for this beer. What's up everybody, Just Brewing here, and welcome back to the home brewery for another grain to glass video. This lager was the first lager that I've actually, well, lagered. When it comes down to it, a lager, all that tells you is what type of yeast you used. That doesn't really tell you what processes or how long the beer sat. I mean, really, that just means you used lager yeast. And in this case, I've done that a number of times. I've used real lager yeast a couple times, and I've made a number of pseudo lagers using ale yeast and, you know, clarifying it different ways, just making sure that you choose a clean yeast to give you that clean, crisp flavor that a typical lager gives you. Well, this was my first tried and true Mexican lager, and I let this bad boy sit for like 6 weeks before it actually started coming out of the tap regularly, and I want to tell you all about it. If this is the kind of content that you like, make sure you like and subscribe if you haven't already. If you want to support me and the channel, you can visit justbrewing.com, where you can donate to me directly, and you can visit justbrewing.com/merch and pick up some merch, where all proceeds are going to be going to charity. Now, I would definitely call this Mexican lager that I brewed a traditional one. It does have Mexican lager yeast with your traditional Mexican lager grain bill, you know, a pale base malt and a bit of corn and things like that in it. It's gonna be clean and crisp. But where I didn't go traditional was the hop. Now, there are a few ways you can take this. Really, almost any lager or pale hop is gonna work here, so long as you keep the IBUs pretty low. You don't want this to be too hoppy. You just want a little bit of hop flavor to carry out some of the other flavors that are gonna be in the beer. Your hops aren't generally gonna be the highlight of a Mexican lager, but it all kind of depends on what flavors you're going for. And for me, I was going for some lemon lime flavors. The last Mexican lager that I did, it was a pseudo lager, but I put lime juice right into the keg. Now, that was fantastic at the very beginning. It saved us the time of either squirting lime juice into it or cutting a lime and juicing it that way. It saved us quite a bit of time when we were drinking this beer, but it did kind of go bad after like a week or so in the keg. It just didn't taste that good after a while. So this time around, I wanted to do something a little different. I decided to go with Motueka, a New Zealand hop, very popular in New Zealand pilsners, and it's actually popping up in some pales and IPAs that I've seen. But this one in particular, some of the notes that it offers are exactly what I need. Lemon, lime, I'm talking bright citrus zest. It's an awesome hop, and it's the first time I've used it. I did get this recipe off of beerandbrewing.com. Link in the description if you want to see exactly what it is and the detailed breakdown description of this beer. Definitely click the link in the description if you're interested. But let's go ahead and get started with the brew day. For this beer, the base malt is gonna be Maris Otter. Maris Otter is a fan favorite of mine personally. I love this base malt, and I think it has a lot more to offer than a simple two-row because of its nutty and some of the other malty flavors that it has. It's not gonna offer too much, but it's definitely more than two-row. Of course, we add a few pounds of flaked corn, a little bit of Pilsner malt, and some Munich malt, both for a little bit of crispness and just a touch of color. We're gonna mash at 148 for an hour, and then we're gonna yank our grains and get this to a boil. For hops, I mentioned it earlier, but I'm going with a single hop, and it's Motueka. At the top of our boil, we're going with half an ounce. With 20 minutes left in our boil, yet another half ounce. And with about 5 minutes left, we're going with a full ounce of Motueka right at the 5 minute mark. At the end of our boil, I chill it and get it into a sanitized fermenter. I'm gonna be using my Fermzilla, and I'm gonna ferment this at about 10 pounds of pressure for probably like 2 weeks at 68 degrees Fahrenheit. I'm choosing 68 mostly because I've got other ale yeasts fermenting at this time, and I mean, I'm gonna, throughout the entirety of this beer, I'm going to be brewing probably like 4 beers around this Mexican lager. So I do need to leave it at ale temperatures for a while before it actually sees lager temps. After about 3 weeks in the fermenter in the chamber at around 68 degrees, I did bump it up just a little bit for a diacetyl rest. I'm not sure if that's necessary when it's under pressure like this, but I did it anyway. At the end of this diacetyl rest, I dropped the temperature to about 38 degrees in my fermentation chamber. After a few weeks in lager temps, it was about time for me to brew again, so I did have to keg that beer. I sanitized and purged a corny keg and made sure there was a bit of biofine at the bottom. And when it came time, I transferred out of the Firmzilla, oxygenless, into the corny keg. Now, this is made easy with the pressure system with the Firmzilla, the floating dip tube, and you know, a CO2 tank. So it was really easy to do. I was able to transfer it out of the Firmzilla into the keg, and it just sat in the keezer for another 4 or so weeks. I was tasting this from time to time, and it tasted absolutely fantastic. Arguably the best Mexican lager, or even the best lager that I've made. And it was an absolutely amazing beer, and I wanted to make sure that it got better, so I left it alone. Patience is not something that I always practice when it comes to my brewing, but when it comes down to it, I know that you can make a good beer just by waiting. I was brewing around this one tap just to make sure that it could continue lagering, it would clear up, and it would get really, really crisp and clean when it was time to actually tap the keg. And that time came, maybe a couple weeks ago. We were doing a little bit of traveling, so there was some time where we weren't home, and I figured that was the perfect time to lager it. So I left it alone, and once we got back, I figured, you know what, I think it's time. I made sure it was properly carbonated, and I let the tap flow. This beer has been absolutely amazing, and this is what it looks like in a glass. This beer is probably the clearest one that I've ever brewed. And granted, I didn't do it on my own. I did use Biofine, and like 6 weeks in the keg at 34 degrees really, really helps clarify things. So it's no secret. I mean, obviously it's gonna be super, super clear at this point, but boy, was it really, really cool to see it go from your standard looking homebrew all the way to now what could come out of a bottle out of a gas station, or, you know, out of the tap at a brewery. I mean, this thing looks absolutely perfect. On the nose, you do get a touch of the corn, a little bit of graininess. You don't get as much of the hop aroma now, but you still get a touch of citrus. When it comes to the flavor, it is textbook Mexican lager. I'm talking corn flavor with just a touch of lemon lime zest, specifically the zest, not so much like the juice, but you do get just citrus and zest. I mean, it's awesome, and I think it's exactly what you want, especially if you're not trying to add lime juice or anything like that, you know, sea salt or anything into your can or your bottle or your pint. I mean, this is a really, really good alternative. I mean, this hop was perfect for a Mexican lager, and I'm really, really glad that I read that article. The article mentions that this beer, the end product, should kind of be like a corn tortilla. You want a little bit of the nutty breadiness from the Maris Otter, and the corn from it being, you know, a Mexican lager, and the lime zest and lemon flavor that you get out of usually just adding some juice to your pint. You get that out of a hop, which is really, really cool. I mean, I took the effort during brew day to make sure you don't have to take the effort when you're drinking it. And I think that's really cool. I'm glad that I found the article. Really, I found it in a Facebook thread. I'm in a number of homebrew groups on Facebook, and this one in particular, someone shared it, and it looked absolutely awesome. So I read the article, and I agreed completely with what they were saying in the article, and I figured I have to brew this myself. It's about time that I put another lager on tap, and we love Mexican lagers here. That's no secret. So it was just time for another Mexican lager. This time, it was gonna be a little bit different. I was gonna wait it out. I can't wait to brew this one again. When I do, I'm definitely gonna add more hops and maybe just a little bit more corn as well. Some of the corn flavor comes through, but maybe not enough for me personally. And that's kind of odd because one of the last times I brewed this, I said there was too much, so I needed to dial it back. I think I may dial it up for this one. On the hops, I would probably add maybe like an extra 1/2 ounce at the tail end of the boil, or maybe at like a whirlpool or even dry hopping. Where it is right now, the beer is good, but I do wish there was more of that Motueka flavor, the citrus and lemon lime zest that it has to offer. I just wish there was a little bit more of it. So next time I brew this beer, I'm just gonna add a little bit more corn and a little bit more hops. This Mexican lager taught me that, well, patience is a virtue. The beer was really good when I first tapped it, and it got better with time. And I think right now it's as good as it's gonna get. I do wish there was a little more flavor, but that's an easy fix for next time. What about you? What's the longest you've waited for a beer? Weeks, months for a lager, or even longer for stouts and sours? I mean, those can take months and months, sometimes even years, to get their peak potential. Let me know in the comments. That should set me at ease for how long I'm gonna have to wait for the next Mexican lager. Until then, thanks for viewing, Just Brewing.